Hello guys, I just wanted to give you a quick, maybe not so quick, overview of figurative art that we are going to study this semester. As any art, figurative art involves different degrees of abstraction that were kind of recorded by Theo van Doesburg in the beginning of 20th century. And he created first the sketch of the cow. Kind of pretty sketchy, but from real life, and you can tell that it's a cow. Then he created a kind of more abstracted form. So from realistic cow, he kind of converted it to more combination of geometric shapes. Then from this sketch, he created this tempera painting. And as you can see, it's even more kind of cubistic and geometric. And then finally, all these cubes. But what started from real sketch of the cow, he came to that. And that's what we call non-objective art, but it all was based on a cow. So as you can see from here and to the first sketch, there is quite a big difference, but it all started from one sketch. So having a cow in mind, you actually can create non-objective art. The same with the figure. So, and I will talk about different forms of human form representation in art, but first I want to kind of talk about why we want to study the human form. And the first, I need to say that human figure is the most difficult and most important subject for artists. It requires the most refined drawing skills. And if you master the skills, you'll be in great demand as an artist in your future professional field. It's a long-lasting tradition of our civilizations. Civilization that began from Roman and Greek culture. And this is just cannot be overlooked. And although in the 20th century, it was proclaimed, it was such a period of time when it was proclaimed that it was the end of the figure in art. And many artists felt that painting or drawing figure is no longer valid. They're just not real artists if they don't paint abstraction. But today you can see reverse movement and multiple artists are learning figure drawing skills again and paying very high prices to learn these skills. And finally, learning human form is just learning who we are. We are all humans and we all feel interest to other humans. And looking at the human model, it's just looking at ourselves in the mirror. This is who we are. Study of life models in a class, it's just as important as study of human body for biology students or for medical students. The nude, just a study of the nude for us, for artists, just has as much importance as for artists, just as for medical students study of the human body, and it has nothing to do with popular sexualization of images in advertising and movies. So when we look at the figure, we gain new knowledge and we practice our professional activity. So please keep this in mind. So again, coming back to various degrees of abstraction, as you can see, you can draw from life and it looks like a real human figure, or it can look like that. But William de Kooning, again, if you look at the year, when in 1975, still that kind of approach was considered more valid. And Wayne Thiebaud, I have always trouble pronouncing his name, but I really, really like this artist. He was one of the very few who still practiced drawing a figure and not abstracting it too much. However, he became famous with the painting of cakes, which looked a little bit more abstracted than human figure. And if you search his name, I'm hoping that you will enjoy his art. Mostly you'll see a lot of different paintings of cakes. Again, kind of you can draw a figure like that, or you can draw a figure looking like that. And all the this study on the right by Paul Cadmus, I will be trying to teach you in this class to draw figure more realistically, and I hope that you will be applying all your efforts to learn to draw realistically. For your final project in this class, I would allow you different forms of expression, and then you can draw a figure in more abstract way. So kind of looking on this Pablo Picasso cubist drawing. And today I also wanted to touch base with you on kind of a little bit of philosophy and talk about two major approaches in figurative art. And these two approaches is formalism and expressionism. So speaking about formalism, approach of the formalist is very disciplined and rational, governed by intellect. Formalists are focusing on formal elements such as lines, light, structural relationships of form, spatial position of body in space, not so much with expression. For example, the artist Degas, his work is an example of formalist approach. Very often in formalist approach figure drawing, figure drawings, we don't see the models, figure models' face, which is kind of, face is the most kind of revealing of the personality or emotions. And in this case, it's often hidden, and it's just, we are just enjoying the lines, the colors, the proportions in formalist figure drawing. For example, here again, contemporary artist James Valerio, but we see the back and we enjoy kind of the play of lights and shadows on the human body, not so much thinking about personality or feelings of this person. Wayne Thiebaud said that the figures are not supposed to reveal anything. It's like seeing a stranger in some place. You look at him, you notice his shoes, his suit, but you don't have any particular feeling about him. This is philosophy, very much reflecting of philosophy of formalism. And we see kind of the same approach in his drawing. We don't really know anything about this man in this drawing. We're kind of just not feeling any emotions about this. We're just kind of looking at proportions and the light, how light falls on the body. Okay. Repetition and variation on a theme is signature characteristic of formalism. So for example, how Degas, he was focusing on ballerinas and he was drawing ballerinas multiple times. So just kind of basically like a scientific exploration of the same object, subject. And also what figurative formalists believed is that art should be about art. So we don't really want to focus on any depressing subject matter. That's what Henri Matisse said. We're just focusing on what I dream of is an art of balance, of purity and serenity, devoid of troubling or depressing subject matter. So this is one of his work. It's called Dance. And as you can see here, this is more abstracted human figure. And this is when painting is actually reflecting on another form of art or dance. And it's a huge, huge painting. There is another painting like that. It's called Music. And I actually posted here a photo of me so you could see the proportions. So this painting is behind me. This is from 2010 when I visited St. Petersburg, Russia. And this is a photo from the Hermitage when these two huge paintings are in the collection. And as you can see, they're quite large. So one painting about dance, one about music. Both kind of like one form of art is reflecting on another form of art. It's a formalist approach in art. Another artist, James Abbott McNeil Whistler, a very well-known American artist. Also, he said, once said, painting is music in color. So as you can see, well, his paintings are quite beautiful. So he's, I just enjoy looking at his colors, the combination of colors is so beautiful. Not so much emotions in this, but you kind of, if you look for a long time at his paintings, you can hear music. And look at his titles. This title is Symphony in Blue and Pink. This titles of these two portraits, he's not so much reflecting on personality of the person who is in his portrait, but for him it's all about color. So this one is Symphony in Flesh Color in Pink, and this one is called Symphony in White, number one. So even his title reflecting his, that all he's thinking about making art is music, not actually emotions. This is his painting of his mother, and also look at the title. Arrangement in Gray and Black, number one. And we just know that he painted his mother, but for him, his mother was just the subject of arrangement of the elements. Again, a very much formalist approach. And the painting I want to show you next is going to be also formalist, but it's also including a history reference. Look at that. So it's a contemporary artist, and he is, it's a drawing. He's very, very realistic, but he is positioning his model exactly in the same position as Whistler's mother, and even looking at the same composition. So it's another formalist approach where artist is even putting it in the title. He wants us to know that he's doing it after Whistler. We call this homage, when artist is doing kind of honor, including the reference to another artist in his or her paintings or drawings. Another formalist artist is Richard Diebenkorn. Again, he has multiple sketches. Look at his lines. Look how many erased lines here. So he's drawing one drawing, then he's wiping it out, erasing it, leaving the ghost image, and drawing another drawing on top of that. This is one type of the study that I would want you to do later as well. But again, for him, study of the figure is just pure formalist study of the composition. And here is the same, he's doing the same with color, just a compositional study. So where the kind of window, the shapes on the wall are just as important as shapes of the figure. Edward Hopper is another formalist artist. For him, figure is just part of interior. And the light, how the light falls on the figure, that how figure is light, and the figure is just as light and stands out in the dark wall. And it's just, it's very beautiful paintings, but they're formalist in the character. Philip Perlstein. Very interesting artist, also only one of the few artists in 70s who were focusing on human figure. He was doing mostly watercolor, so all of the, his works are watercolor drawings. As you can see here, the head is cropped off. In formalist figurative art, the head is very often kind of hidden or cropped off simply because the figure is just a part of the composition. Another Perlstein study of the nude reclining on the sofa. There are two models. As you can see here, just kind of like the positioning of the figures, one across, one against another, kind of forming a cross and kind of diagonal lines. This is what's most important to him. There is no story hidden behind his compositions. Here, he's focusing on the shadow. It's probably the most interesting part of this composition, and the shadow on the wall, very complex. Another study. He usually is reflecting some kind of parts of the environments that are very complex, very, you know, kind of demanding to draw. For example, this design pattern on the floor. Expressionism. So what expressionists are focusing on? So the first expressionist artist who we kind of know, who the most expressionist of all, probably the one who made this famous artwork called Scream, and it's Edward Munch. And he said once, just as Leonardo da Vinci studied human anatomy and dissected corpses, so I try to dissect souls. So this is what's most important for figurative expressionists. Their approach is governed by emotions. They're focused on gesture and expression. And the human figure has unlimited number of various expressions and possibilities to express various emotions depending on the gesture, depending on the different positions of the body. So artist in this case, in expressionist approach, is more concerned with meaning. And we see a very similar expressionistic approach in the works of Van Gogh. This is his famous painting, Potato Eaters. He was very concerned with human relationships, human emotions, and the life of simple people. Here is the Van Gogh quote. What is drawing? It is working oneself through an invisible iron wall that seems to stand between what one feels and what one can do. We can all relate to this statement, overcoming some problems in our art. And apparently for Van Gogh, he was very interested in expressing what he feels and what he wants to speak through his models about human emotions. Apparently this model's pose was very important for Van Gogh because he hired various models, men and women, and he asked them to sit in that pose. And there are various drawings survived after Van Gogh that he was drawing people in this pose. Here is another one, old man with his head in his hands, and there are multiple others. Very similar pose by different artists. Also, she was very interested in human emotions. Kathy Kollwitz, a woman with dead child. Very interesting artist. I really recommend you to look at more of her work. She was very concerned with struggling humanity, and you can see this great compassion to suffering of others in her art. This is another one of her work, and the quote of what she felt was important for her art. And if you compare her work, for example, with formalist art, such as this one by Ira Korman, this is a woman making up her bed. This is just some daily routine. It's not really much about suffering. We don't know about this woman's emotion. Is she happy or is she sad while she's making up her bed? What we are kind of mostly observing here is the beauty of human form, and that's about it. This is the formalist approach. So if you compare these two works, we kind of can see it side by side and compare. I wanted you to look up this video by Clara Liu. She's a professor in Rhode Island School of Art and Design, and she's very passionate about figure drawing. And if you looked at her video that I recommended to you first week, you could also see her posts of her own work. She also brings up many figurative works in her video. And you can just see how this is her favorite model of all times, an older woman. So when we draw models, it's not always that we're drawing beautiful young girls or beautiful, you know, muscular white men. People are beautiful in all kinds of forms. And as Clara Liu said in her video, it was the most beautiful person she had ever seen. And after drawing this woman, it was boring for her to draw just, you know, younger 20 years old models because they don't have any wrinkles. And wrinkly skin is very difficult to draw, but also it tells a lot of stories about life, and just very interesting and very demanding as well to draw. So again, coming back to figurative formalism and figurative expressionism, sometimes artists can do both. For example, Paul Cadmus, most of his art, we see a formalism in his art, so just not very much expressing emotions, it's just admiring the beauty of human form. And he was mostly admiring the beauty of male human form. And he mostly was drawing his partner who, you know, he was gay, and his model is mostly his partner who they lived together for many, many years. But also Paul Cadmus is known for some narrative drawings, paintings, actually it's a painting, and he's telling a story. So this is completely different approach, and one artist is capable in doing both. This is another very expressionistic work by Paul Cadmus when he's addressing some, you know, ugly issues in our society. So this is one is about lynching, 1935. Picasso, another artist, and Picasso started his path as an expressionist artist. So this one of his works from the Blue Period, The Old Guitarist. As you can see, it's kind of more abstracted form, very expressive, expressionistic, but it's still more realistic than the work he's in the style that he developed later, which was called Cubism. And Cubism work is can be considered much more formalist, because what formalists do, they're mostly concerned with how you display the form. And here Picasso invented his own way how to display the human form that nobody did before him, and he's really kind of working on it, developing the style more and more. So just to summarize it, formalism was more characteristic to modernism of 20th century. And their main principle, main motto is art should be about art, aesthetic problems and form are the most important in art. And then expressionism, artists whose philosophy is expressionism, they believe that content is more important than form. Or this issue brings us to postmodernism, and when you take more advanced classes in art history, you will find out more about postmodernism. But basically, in postmodernism, we see reintroducing representational and content-based art that deals with life issues, and that's what we see today in art. I wanted to mention to you also narrative art as a form of expressionist art, and that narrative art tells a story. So this is an example of painting from Artemisia Gentileschi, artist, female artist from Baroque period. And this is a story about Judith. And it's a biblical story, and Artemisia Gentileschi painted many other biblical stories, mostly focused on women. This is a contemporary artist, Julie Schneider, and it's the same story about Judith. If you're interested about this story, you can Google it. It's a fascinating story from a Bible. And so this is a contemporary artist approach, same story, different approach. But it's a reference to art story, also has a feminist statement behind the story. Another feminist artist, Sylvia Slade, she was working in the 70s. And as you can see here, a nude man, a group of six nude men, they're all her friends, and one of them is her husband. And why she created this painting? She created this painting because she was reflecting also on history from the past, history of art from the past. There was this artist, Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, a French artist of 19th century, and it's a famous painting by him from 1862 that showed a lot of different nude women. It's basically, it's a harem. And as you can see here, it's her reflection. She was always kind of reflecting on the issue, why is it always that women are represented nude in the painting? Let me replace them with nude man figures. So this is her variation of this painting. Another her variation on the historic painting is this painting of her male friend, Philip Golub. Philip Golub also was an artist. Well, here you can see he's quite young there. He's looking in the mirror. He's kind of reclining on the sofa. Behind him is a mirror, and you can see reflection of an artist herself. She's painting him, and it's a kind of a self-portrait also as well. This is her reflection on this famous painting by Velázquez, Rocky by Venus. So if you studied art history already, you probably remember this painting by Velázquez. And again, we can see in the past, artists preferred to paint beautiful women reclining. And this is her feminist statement, I am a female artist and my model is a beautiful nude man. So she's kind of reversing the roles in this painting. Another contemporary artist, Jenny Savey. So she's utilizing distortion in her paintings. And kind of we see in her paintings protest against viewing women as objects. And she was also making a lot of different paintings about body you know, mutilations and body surgery and so on. Another artist who created a lot of interesting figurative art is Frida Kahlo. And I'm sure you know this artist, and kind of she's employing some personal, all of her paintings are personal story, and she's employing some surrealism. So for example, this is doubling of herself, self, double self-portrait, two Fridas. This is a painting by my teacher in the past. She was teaching figure drawing in Minnesota State University, Moorhead, where I received my bachelor's degree. And this also her personal story and her self-portrait. An interesting work for me, and I'm fascinated by her art. And this is another artist who I was taking workshop with, Stephen Early, a very interesting artist. And also here, Stephen Early, in many ways, he's maybe a formalist artist because he's a teacher, so he's just kind of focusing on a human form and how to represent human form. But also, if you look at his website, you will see that in many of his work, kind of there is a lot of passion and a lot of emotion. So I think that he's, in fact, he's more expressionist artist rather than formalist. If you look at my work, and you can see my work at alaparsons.com, my website, you can see that I'm probably more expressionist artist rather than formalist. However, I also have some work that just focus on the representation of beauty of nature. For example, some of my paintings of flowers, paintings of landscape, they're just basically kind of focusing on the beauty of the nature, and they can be considered formalist. But if you look at some of my work that I title this work, I kind of define it as magic realism. And you can also find definition of magic realism on my website. This work is more expressionistic. And also on my website, you can find some links to student work from the past that I post all my students' work on my website because I'm proud of it. And I hope that in this class, you will create work that I will be proud of as well. And I will, with your permission, post it on my website. So after this presentation, I want you to choose a work by the artist who you like and also write me a short reflection on what do you think this work is. Is it formalist or is it expressionist? And why do you think so? For example, this is one of my favorite artists, Paolo Rego. This work is titled Swallows. What do you think this type of art is? Expressionist or formalist, and why? So I'm looking forward to your submissions for the this week art journal, and I will post the drawing assignment shortly. Goodbye for now.